If you're just joining us, welcome to the GU Oncology Conference Highlights, focused on ASCO GU 2022. We'll be starting with kidney cancer highlights presented by Dr. Vincent Chu with Tony Schwery as a discussant. Just a quick comment, please put any questions during the presentation in the chat, and we'll have time for discussion at the end. And so without further ado, Vincent, do you want to I will advance slides as needed.
Thanks, Jake. I will start by this from KEYNOTE-564, which is the adjuvant trial that investigated pembrolizumab after nephrectomy for patients with high-risk localized renal cell carcinoma. Now, this data was first presented last year and published in New England Journal of Medicine. And at GU ASCO, this is the updated 30-month data cutoff for both DFS and for OS. So as we know, KEYNOTE-564 compared placebo versus pembrolizumab in patients with high-risk localized RCC, status post-resection, and it established a role for adjuvant pembrolizumab in clear cell RCC, leading to, as well, the FDA approval for adjuvant pembrolizumab for this indication 3 months ago. Previously, 24 months of data were presented, and this update includes an additional 6 months of data with a data cutoff of June 2021. As context, I think it's important to keep in mind the eligibility criteria for KEYNOTE-564. This included histologically confirmed clear cell renal cell carcinoma that was intermediate high risk, or also patients who were M1-NED, meaning that they had metastatic, oligometastatic disease at time of presentation, which was completely resected within 1 year of nephrectomy. Patients were required to have gone no prior systemic therapy and were randomized 1:1, and the primary endpoints were disease-free survival, as assessed per investigator, as well as overall survival as a key secondary endpoint. Next slide. So the KEYNOTE-564 update showed that disease-free survival benefit was maintained well at 30 months, with the curve remaining quite separate with additional 6 months of data and with a stable hazard ratio, strongly favoring pembrolizumab over placebo. Hazard ratio remains at 0.63, and the nominal p-value remains at less than 0.0001. As you recall, previously reported, including in the New England Journal paper from last year, was a hazard ratio of 0.68. And so this hazard ratio has remained stable, and in fact improved a little bit with the new data. In addition, the disease-free survival benefit was seen in the intermediate high risk, the high risk, and the M1-NED subgroups. And in all three groups, there is clear difference between pembrolizumab and placebo, and the confidence intervals continue to favor pembrolizumab in all groups, although because of the lower number of patients, with only about 40 patients per arm in the high risk group, the confidence interval does cross one. Next slide. So subset analyses continue also to show benefit of pembrolizumab in all subgroups, with every subgroup favoring pembrolizumab over placebo. Of note, this includes patients with both high-grade and low-grade tumors, although patients with sarcomatoid features, what we might consider the patients with the highest grade tumors, appear to have especially large magnitude of benefit with a hazard ratio of about 0.54. So my takeaway from these subset analyses by grade is that patients with low grade tumors still appear to have some benefit from pembrolizumab, certainly the hazard ratio favoring that over placebo, but with each successive increase in tumor grade, there appears to be greater magnitude of absolute benefit. Now, again, of course, the subgroups, the confidence intervals cross, and this is just hypothetical. Similarly, benefit was seen favoring pembrolizumab regardless of whether PD-L1 status was positive or negative, though again, with wide confidence intervals given the relatively low number of patients. Next, please. In addition, updated overall survival data was presented, and there is an ongoing trend towards improved overall survival among patients who are randomized to pembrolizumab. The number of events remains low, with only 23 events on pembrolizumab and 43 events on placebo, and so the survival data is still not considered mature. The hazard ratio for overall survival was 0.52, favoring pembrolizumab with a p-value of 0.0048. And despite this low p-value, because the number of events is not considered statistically mature, the p-value does not yet cross the pre-specified boundary for statistical significance, which for this analysis is a very strict boundary of 0.000095. So technically not reaching the pre-specified overall survival endpoint yet, but certainly trending in the right direction. So in conclusion, updated data from KEYNOTE-564 showed us that adjuvant pembrolizumab continues to maintain clinical benefit at 30 months follow-up with ongoing separation of DFS and OS curves and a strong trend towards superior OS, though not yet reaching statistical significance. There were no new or unexpected safety signals seen. As you recall, pembrolizumab was associated with a 20.5% chance of requiring systemic steroids, and that safety signal was maintained. And this data shows us that pembrolizumab remains a standard of care for M0 or M1-NED patients who are at high risk of recurrence from clear cell kidney cancer after surgery. So next, I'll discuss an abstract which presented the first data from neoadjuvant avelumab and axitinib in patients with localized renal cell carcinoma who had high risk of recurrence after nephrectomy. So in the perioperative space for renal cell carcinoma, there is FDA approval for most recently pembrolizumab and previous to that sunitinib in the adjuvant space, but no approvals in the neoadjuvant space. And in the past, perioperative trials have predominantly focused on adjuvant as opposed to neoadjuvant treatment. So that being said, the role of neoadjuvant therapy in general, and especially of neoadjuvant IO-TKI therapy, is not known in clear cell kidney cancer. The prior neoadjuvant data have been really, in the modern era, relegated to phase two trials, and the data have been mixed. So sitravatinib and nivolumab, which is a TKI-IO combo, previously showed an overall response rate of about 12% presented at GU ASCO last year. And single agent data has been a little bit all over the map, with axitinib ranging from an overall response rate of 14% to over 45% in prior phase two trials, and pazopanib previously showing an overall response rate of 14%. NeoAV-AX was designed as a neoadjuvant trial investigating this IO-TKI combination. Patients who were enrolled received both axitinib and avelumab prior to surgery. And if patients tolerated well at 4 weeks, they were increased to 7 milligrams axitinib BID from a starting dose of 5. And after week 8, they were permitted to increase to 10 milligrams axitinib BID. The primary endpoint was overall response rate greater than or equal to 25%. So here are the headline results from this trial. Axitinib and avelumab did decrease the size of the primary tumor in the vast majority of patients by absolute terms. Although this translated only to an overall PR rate of 30%. So as you can see here from the waterfall plot, many patients did have slight decrease in tumor size. And of the patients who had no decrease in tumor size, the majority of these people did not have increase either. Among all patients, there was a median of 20% decrease in the tumor dimension. And the spider plot is shown. So I want to take just 1 or 2 minutes to point out that a lot of the work that was presented in the kidney cancer space at GU ASCO did come from our Lank Center. And I'm not going to have time to go over each of these abstracts in the interest of time, but I'm going to present 3 slides just showing the breadth of research currently being done by some of our colleagues. I think putting together all the kidney cancer abstracts, approximately 1/5 to 1/6 involved authors from the Lank Center, which for this international conference was really heartwarming. And so I welcome any discussion questions and comments. I'm gonna try to turn on my video, but my video I think is currently disabled.
So please, right. Have 6 minutes if you have any questions.
Yeah, so Vincent, I'll try to get you access so you can put your video on, but in the meantime, I don't see any questions in the chat, so maybe I'll pose one, Tony, to you, and would love to hear your thoughts in general about any other abstracts from ASCO GU pertaining to kidney cancer that you found interesting. But with Keynote 564, what are your thoughts in terms of how you whether the updated data that we saw at ASCO GU change how you're thinking about it, if at all, are you thinking that the sort of, trend in overall survival is gonna bear out as we get more mature data? Any other findings from the updated data lock that are sort of changing how you think about giving adjuvant Pembro to your kidney cancer patients? Oh, and you're on mute.
Not mute. No, I think this is important. When you talk adjuvant in general and solid tumors, you do have a population of patients that is overtreated, no doubt, whether it's breast, it's lung, it's kidney, it's bladder. And it's important to know, as long as the data progress, there has been some hesitancy, adjuvant renal, unlike adjuvant colorectal cancer, for example, hasn't been really a reality till now with Pembro. So any bit of more data is important. And remember, this is 6 more months where patients are not on pembrolizumab. There is no active treatment. So what happens? So the result, we're very pleased with the result with both DFS and OS, even with very little power for overall survival. So I think based on the approval, you have to certainly discuss it with patient now. Hopefully we're gonna, proceed to the next study to push again the envelope further in this disease.
Yeah, and I agree. And there are several adjuvant trials and perioperative trials that are gonna read out soon, including CheckMate 914. And so we're gonna hopefully see soon additional perioperative immunotherapy data in this space. I actually have a question for Tony. Is there any patient in the world that you would now continue to offer adjuvant sunitinib? For example, the patient who has an absolute contraindication to IO, is sunitinib still alive in this setting?
I mean, I have not. Patient that came with me on sunitinib already, I have continued it, for second opinion, but I have not. I mean, the data with sunitinib is very controversial. Despite you have one trial positive, you have many trials with VEGF TKI that have been negative. When we looked at the ECOG study, the large study, and we adjusted, with the same eligibility criteria, we matched them in a way there was no benefit, coupled with quality of life and the absence of overall survival benefit with longer follow-up, the answer is no, now that you have pembrolizumab as an option. And, whenever you have an autoimmune disease, you have to discuss how is it? Is it active, et cetera? If they're very active, they may not be eligible for any therapy.
Great, thanks. And in the interest of time, I'm going to move us on in just a second, but we have just another minute for kidney cancer. And Tony, maybe I was maybe you could quickly comment for the group on ongoing trials that you think are have the potential to, you know, change the landscape of kidney cancer systemic therapy.
So ongoing adjuvant trial, where there is a trial with adjuvant.
I was going to say adjuvant or otherwise.
Yeah, adjuvant, there is adjuvant atezolizumab, neoadjuvant nevo, and then adjuvant nevo. And there's an important study with adjuvant 6 months of nivolumab. So that's duration, because the pembro, what Vincent presented, the pembro is 1 year, 6 months of nivolumab or 6 months of nevo ipi. So that is different. This is differentiated. You know, so those are the main one happening, and we're working on intensifying therapy more than pembro here. Regarding metastatic disease, I think winter is coming, and winter is the triplets. So we do have now trials with triplet. One of them finished accrual with nevo ipi cabo versus nevo ipi. Results expected at some point. And another one, a very large pivotal trial with triplet with CTLA-4 inhibitor and HIF-2 inhibitor that are accruing.
Great, thanks. Thank you, Vincent and Tony, for the presentation and discussing kidney cancer.